Good afternoon. Huh? So an astronaut and a neurosurgeon walk into a room. It's not the start of a bad joke. But before that happens, before they walk into the room, let's think about that. What are the odds that both would be in the room? What are the odds that both would be African American? What are the odds that both would be women? Before they walk into the room, let me take you back. I would say just a few years, but I'm class of 91, so it's a lot of years ago. My senior year at Dartmouth, I was invited to a dinner to honor a newly designated astronaut. She was African American, and she was a woman. And she would later make history going into space as the first African American woman in space. I'm referring to none other than Dr. Mae Jamison. And at the time, I was just super, super honored. Couldn't believe that they had asked me to attend this dinner. Later, we were also invited to her talk, as is the custom in academics. I think I will always remember the title of that talk. What does E equals MC squared have to do with primping in the mirror on a Saturday night? Well, I can't recall all the details of what she actually said, because again, it was a few years ago. But I do remember the sentiments packed into that title. Dr. Jamison was taking something as complex as E equals MC squared, and she was translating it into something simple, something real, something almost quotidian, like primping in a mirror. I didn't know it then, but that talk and that whole experience became a bridge to my future in science. It was the first time that I saw science as real. It was the first time that I actually thought of science through the lens of gender. And it was the first time that I thought of science as something social and accessible, like primping in a mirror. Here was someone who looked like me, an African-American woman. Here was someone who had taken a path that I was about to embark on, medical school. It was the first time I felt the limitless bounds of my future. Again, you're not going to always remember the details, but you will always remember how you felt. And in that moment, I felt invincible. I took this whole experience, the dinner, the talk, the meeting with Dr. Jamison, I took it as a call then, and it continued to be a call now. It was a call that science could be real. Science could be nuanced. Science could be accessible. And most importantly, as an African-American girl, it was a reminder, or actually a notification, that science could be something that I could actually do. Now, my path in STEM has been fairly straightforward. After leaving Dartmouth, I went to Stanford for medical school, and then I went on to complete a residency in neurosurgery. Along the way, I got a master's in public health and focused on epidemiology. My goal was to use data to bridge to the bedside. Back then, epidemiology was a rarely utilized tool in neurosurgery, and I had hoped to change that, to add it in the armamentarium against trauma. Again, I really wanted to bridge that huge divide that research had in our field to the bedside. Now, I've continued to focus my career in trauma and trauma research. And over the years, I have researched many things with a narrow and narrow focus on subcohorts. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the first part of my career and my current research studies. The first part of my career was focused on the developing world. I wanted to examine whether trauma in the different communities had differing outcomes, and whether or not our infrastructure, our research, could actually help bridge the differences in outcome. And so we looked at all trauma admissions in a developing world healthcare system that focused on trauma. We then chose a similar institution in the United States and studied them simultaneously. Both institutions had a trauma focus, and both institutions had similar missions. Now, I won't go into all the epidemiology and all the methodologies, because it's beyond the scope of the time allotted here. But what we found was that despite advanced technologies and despite aggressive in-hospital neurosurgical support, the outcomes were actually comparable in both the developed and the developing world for those having suffered brain injury. But when we stratified the data and looked at the smaller subset, those most severely injured, we then saw differences. And what that highlighted for us was that where we were seeing most of the outcome was not where we were putting most of the resources. And in fact, perhaps our current methodologies needed to be examined and perhaps changed. Overall, this highlighted for us that we needed to re-examine, to take a step back from the granular and look at the macro trends in our fields. Later, I now study gender and traumatic brain injury. And we approached that in a similar way. We were concerned that the volume of data that was being acquired in research on brain injury and in trauma, women were actually the minority in those subpopulations. And our concern was that in those data sets, they were actually noise, and that these studies were clouding the true outcomes. And so we wanted to apply data to potentially impact the different outcomes. So we sought to tease this out and use nuanced and new methodologies specific to looking at smaller and smaller data sets. And we looked at multiple domains, and what we found was that women actually had differing outcomes in several of the domains that we examined, different from the general cohort and different from their male cohorts. Our research highlighted that gender does indeed matter. It not only matters in traumatic brain injury research, but it matters in research, period. This work has served as foundational for our current research, where we continue to examine smaller and smaller cohorts, cohorts that are otherwise ignored in data sets. We are now focusing on functional and physiologic differences that these cohorts might have, and we are using neuroimaging and neuropsychological testing to better understand. We are really trying to make this data foundational for all research. Throughout, my main goal in everything that I've done in all of this research, it's really been to understand first and to then make meaningful contributions to the patients that we serve. In all these endeavors, I have really tried to make sure that the data and the tools that we use bridge the gap that exists in our understanding and our ultimate treatment strategies. I have also sought to make sure that what we are doing, that the science is grounded in ways that are real, in ways that are nuanced, and in ways that are accessible, all with impact. I have sought to bridge my work to the same call of earlier years, the interaction before. And so as we look to today and to our future, I'm reminded, both by the introduction, but also by this venue, I'm reminded that about a year ago this time, I was promoted to the rank of professor in my field. Now, normally, people celebrate this with close family or close friends, and you might go out to dinner or, you know, have a drink. But my promotion received significant fanfare in it being historic, simply by not only having been promoted, but that I was an African-American woman in a field dominated by men. As a result of the help of social media, I found myself with a platform that had not been afforded to the women who came before me, albeit few. And from that, I had significant opportunities to use my voice in this moment. I'm going to share one experience with you as it relates to the theme of bridging. There was a CNBC article that was published titled, "This Stanford Neurosurgeon's Promotion Just Made History. Here's Why This Is a Big Deal for STEM." And in the article, the author asks, essentially, You know, what are you doing with your life? Like, why is this important? What have you accomplished? Well, like I said, it's been a while since I graduated Dartmouth, so I'm a little older. And I think one of the benefits of being older is taking time to reflect. And in reflecting, I realized that the author was also asking sort of, what are you going to do with your life? How are you going to bridge the opportunity gap for others in your field? How will your promotion make a difference? I'm happy to say that my clinical work, beyond my academic career, that I have actually really been focused on that. I have heeded the call of Dr. Jameson from so many years ago, and I believe that I have met that challenge. I've been focused on priming the pipeline. I believe strongly that opportunities and access are limited, and that we actually have a role in changing that. So, at my institution, which I'm happy supports this vision, we have been successful in launching initiatives focused on exposing girls to the healthcare science, the healthcare system, and neurosciences. We have exposed minority youths to the neurosciences. And we have worked hard to make the neurosciences accessible to all students, not just those who traditionally had a place at the table. This is all to bridge for others, while importantly bridging to our collective future. Now, years later, this was actually a couple years ago, I was invited to a lunch at Stanford now, also to honor Dr. Mae Jameson. It turns out that the woman who did this work at Dartmouth was now at Stanford doing the same work. She didn't actually remember me, but I made the short list of African-American faculty at Stanford. And so I was invited to this lunch. I was super excited. I thought, oh my gosh, I get to like talk to Dr. Jameson, you know, tell her all of these things that have happened to me. And of course, I really thought I would just be reminding her, right? Of course, she would remember. And so I arrived at this lunch, and I arrived, of course, a little bit early, and I was comforted in seeing that it was, again, going to be a small gathering. And so we sat down, and we went around the room, and everybody introduced themselves. And when it came to me, of course, I told her how I'd had dinner with her, I told her about the talk, I told her everything. And again, I didn't actually think I was telling her, I thought we were sharing this moment. And after this, Dr. Jameson actually didn't remember. And I thought, oh my gosh, how could she not remember me? I mean, she'd had this unprecedented career, she'd gone into space, but how could she not remember me? I chuckle at the self-centered naivete that actually thought she would remember. I mean, I have lots of conversations never having been to space here on Earth, and I can hardly remember most of those. But as I looked around the room, I saw that Dr. Jameson was doing it again. She was inspiring yet another generation. She was making science real for them. It was a welcome reminder of the ultimate goal of the work that we had been doing, that I had been doing. Not only in changing the lives of the patients that we serve, but a future inspiring the next generation, those who will do the work when we no longer are doing it. And a reminder that the future will and the future has to be different. So I may never go into space like Dr. Jameson, but I am comforted in knowing that there is a generation of girls and African-American youth who can look to my work and to the work of Dr. Jameson and an increasing collective of African-American physicians and scientists. And they will know that you can marry physics and science and life. They will know that they too can make science real in their lives, that they can do brain surgery in the morning and pick up their kids in the evening, that they too can understand E equals MC squared and also primp in the mirror. So when an astronaut and a neurosurgeon walk into the room, both African American, both women. It won't be a joke. It will actually be their reality. Thank you.